Thank you, Jesus. Y'all can be seated. God is good. I'm telling you. I always have a good time when I come into the presence of the Lord.
Yes.
Amen. Always have a good time. I want to talk to you this morning about a subject that's pretty dear to me, correct? Because I'm having to learn. And, you know, like Pastor Bill is talking about some things happening, you know, Pastor Doc should be talking about these things, everything's happening. And there are stuff that's happening. You know, I mean, your brain would have to be shut down, you know, and you not be able to see, hear, or anything to not see that the things in this world is going on, correct? And I don't know about y'all, but if you just open up the Bible, you see everything that's going on is written right there in the Bible, you know. But yet still people don't believe. But there is a lot of things that are going on in the world. And a lot of things that the Lord told us was going to happen during this time. But also, so many of the things that are going on involves people's attitudes. People's attitudes. I've never in my life seen such hate out of people. You know, I mean, just people just hate out of people. You know, right. They have no care about anybody or their feelings or thoughts or whatnot. You know, they human life doesn't mean anything. You know, somebody, they just as soon kill you as to look at you. Same. Right? And I mean, and there's always been that kind of thing. I mean, you know, but man, not on the scale that we see today. You know, not at least not in my lifetime. You know, not on the scale that we see today. And so, that's why this particular subject is really becoming more and more dear to me. We're going to talk about a mission of love. Mission of love. We should be on a mission of love.
Yes.
We see a lot of things going on in the world. We do. And it affects us. Touches us all. But we should be on a mission of love. God called us to be different. He called us to come out,
you know,
and to be different. And we should be on a mission of love. You know, people are not going to be changed. People are not going to receive the Lord Jesus Christ if they don't see something different out of somebody who professes to follow Him.
Yes.
Yes. You know? And so we have to be different than what they are.
Thanks, God.
We have to stand our ground. For one thing, too, we have to stand our ground. Oh my gosh. If we say that we love the Lord Jesus Christ and we follow Him, then we need to stand our ground.
Amen.
And say, we're for Jesus no matter what. I'm going to tell you, you're going to see a lot of people been confessing Jesus for many, many years, and you're going to see a lot of them fold under pressure. That's why we have to stay close to the Lord. You know, the Lord said, forsake not the assemblings of yourselves together, and even more so as you see the day approaching, you know.
Yes.
I'm going to tell you, the day is not approaching. We're right smack dab in the middle of it.
Amen.
You know, we're right in the middle of it. It ain't approaching on us anymore. We're there. And so, He said for us to assemble, not to forsake ourselves. Why? I mean, there's many reasons, but why would He tell us that? Why would He make that so important when you see the day approaching? Because there is power in the numbers. There is power when we gather together as one. There is power in that. You receive strength. I receive strength. We glorify God. But we stand for the Lord Jesus Christ. If we don't assemble as a body, right, then your power is not going to be as effective. Why? Because you're going to be surrounded by a bunch of garbage all the time.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Think about it. I used to tell people years ago, you know, when I was working, in secular jobs and whatnot, and they talk about, you know, sometimes about me going to church all the time. I said, man, I got to go to church.
Right.
I said, I got to go to church. Yeah, I go every time the doors is open and stuff like that, you know. I tell them, why is that? I said, because I'm out here with all these heathens all the time. You know, I mean, that's just what I told them. I said, I spend so much time with the heathens, right? I said, I got to go and spend some time with some people who love God. You know? Why? Because that built me up, you know.
Yeah.
It built me up. And me and Sister Anne, we've always done that. We have always done that. Always. From day one. You know, when we first started going to church back in a long time ago. You know, when I made a decision, because, you know, when I made a decision I was going to follow the Lord, I said, Lord, I'm going to follow you. Amen. And so we made a decision that no matter what was going on at the church, we would be there. And we were. We were always there. Always there. He changed. We still do it. Why? Because I still need that same strength today that I needed then. Matter of fact, I need it more so today than I needed it then. I thought back then, you know, I was weak. I was a weak Christian. I didn't have a lot of strength. But I thought back then I really needed strength, you know, for just my place in life at that time. But today, oh my gosh, I need it super duper big. Because you don't know from one day to the next what you're going to face when you step out there. But Jesus called us to be different. We should be on a mission of love. It doesn't make no difference what we see going on. We should be on a mission of love. Why is that? Because that's what the Lord told us. That is what the Lord told us. Right? I want you to turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. This is so awesome. Paul really summed this up. You know, when he penned this, he really summed this up. And I think this must have been something that was really on him. There was something that he was seeing out in, and maybe even seeing amongst the followers of Christ. But I know there was things that he was seeing that the world, you know, their world wasn't too easy either. They were under serious persecution. Look at Paul. Paul's in prison and stuff like that. You know, they've been in prison many times. And their world was not real easy to be around either. Christians were persecuted, you know. They were put to death, all kinds of stuff, you know, that was happening to them. And you know, when you fall under that kind of condemnation, it's easy. It's easy to let our flesh rise up, you know. Let our flesh rise up. You know, I can remember the day before I was serving God, right? If somebody did something to me, well, praise God, I want to do it back to them twice as much. You know what I mean? I did. I mean, you know, we got that I'm going to get revenge kind of thing, you know, going on. And I want to do it to them, back to them. I get them. But you know, the Lord, that's not how the Lord wanted us to be. And when we look right here at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, Paul, I'm going to start with verse number 1. Paul said, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity, we all know that charity is love, right? It's translated love. Okay? And have not charity, I have become a sounding brass, a tingling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profits me nothing. Now I want to stop right there for just a second. Because who is Paul talking about right here? See, most of the time we've got to look and see who's being spoken to and these types of things. And who is Paul talking about right here? Paul's talking about Christians. Paul's talking about people who confess to follow Christ. Right? Why? Because we know that if you don't follow Christ, well, you're not going to speak with tongues. Right? You know, I mean, that's a fact. You know that's not going to happen. Right? You're not going to have the gift of prophecy. That kind of thing. You're not going to understand mysteries and stuff. You're not going to have faith to remove mountains. You're not going to have that. So we know that Paul is talking about a Christian. And he said, even though I'm this great Christian, I can do all of these things. I've got great faith and all of that kind of stuff, you know. I mean, I got the gift of prophecy. I can speak to a mountain, and that mountain will remove itself and cast itself off into the sea if that's what I want. He said, even though I can do all of that, he said, if I have not love, he said, all of that is nothing. It means nothing. You know, I have to believe that this was pretty serious on Paul's mind at that time. Yeah. There had to have been something going on that spurred him to write this. You know, it's very possible that there was a lot of the Christian groups at that time was wanting to take up arms against the authorities and whatnot. It's very possible that kind of thing was happening, and he was trying to tell them. God has called us to come out, to be different. They may be doing things that are bad. They may be doing things that are bad to us. They may be doing all of this kind of stuff, but God called us to be different. To be different. Praise God. And that's what people have to see when they see us. Sure. Now then, verse number 4 says, charity suffers long. Suffers long. Is kind. Charity envies not. Charity bothers itself, not itself. It is not puffed up. Does not behave itself unseemly. Seeketh not her own. Is not easily provoked. And thinks no evil. Oh my gosh. Charity suffers long. Love suffers long. Have you ever had to be long-suffering with somebody?
Yes.
I mean, somebody you didn't want to be long-suffering with. You know, have you ever had to be so long-suffering sometimes?
Yeah. Thank you, Jesus.
How long are we going to have to suffer this world the way that it is? I don't know. I really don't know. Right? But however long it is, God has called us to suffer long, to endure it. But to endure it with love. Because I'm going to tell you, when people see that no matter what is happening with us, they see the love of Christ coming out of us, it's going to change them. It's going to change them. Why was that God telling us to do this? For that very reason. Because our love changes people. Because people say, well, they're no different than anybody else. You know, yeah, somebody did something against them. You know, they went out there and beat them up.
Uh-oh. Bad idea.
What's different about that? But when we walk in love, no matter what happens, when we walk in love, somebody is going to be watching. And you might not even know, but somebody's going to be watching and they're going to say, wow. I want what he has.
Woo!
I want what he has. And when we walk in love in this kind of world that we live in, then the word of Christ is spoken to people. I tell people all the time, you know, preach the gospel everywhere you go. Everywhere you go, preach the gospel. And if you have to, use words. Think about it, man. It'll sink in.
Yeah.
That's you know.
It'll
sink in. Why? Because we should just be walking in love. People should see our actions.
Yes.
We should be walking in love. It rejoices not in iniquity. Don't get caught up rejoicing in what you see going on in the world. If we see somebody who we think really deserves something, right, you know, they've done this here, wasn't it? And it comes back on them. Don't rejoice in that. Pray for them. You know, because bottom line is, everybody out there needs Jesus, same as you and me. All of them need Jesus. Man, I was a heathen before I came to the Lord. A heathen. I've done things. I mean, he just knows that was right.
God loves us.
But God does. He does. Praise God because he loves me. So. Thank you, Jesus. But I was a heathen, right? You know. I mean, oh, praise God. I did things I wish I could forget. I wish I could. I wish I could go back. I wish I could go back and change them. I said things I wish I could go back and take back. But I can't. You know, I can't. I can't do any of that. But you know what? Through all of that, God loved me. God saved me. God told me I could be different.
Yes.
That's what he told me. You can be different, Bill.
Yes.
You know, I can. Because honestly and truthfully, I wasn't sure. You know, I mean, in my mind back then, that was a big step. And I knew me.
Yeah.
I knew me well. I knew, bro. I knew I was a heathen. You know, I knew me. And it's hard changing from hedonism into lovingism. One of these days, Sister Anna's going to write a book about all the words that I made up along the way.
Those were good.
Hey, listen, I'm believing one day I'm going to see some of them in the dictionary. Because they've been good words. Yeah. Every time I say one like that, you know, everybody knows what I mean. So, you know, praise God. I think the Holy Ghost gives them to me. But praise God. Yeah, I didn't know if I could change. I didn't know. I just had to trust God. I mean, here I was going to church back then. When I was going to church back then, and I'm surrounded by all of these people who, in my mind, they're, now this is just my thinking about it at the time. You know, you got to think about a heathen mind coming into a church, you know. Right? And I'm thinking about all these goody-goody two-shoes people that I'm surrounded by, you know. And here's this one guy right here, right? You know, that, you know, I'm like, man, I don't know if I can fit in this place or not, you know. Because I said, all these people are going to look at me, and they're going to know who I am. Now, I mean, that's, the devil will tell you that, too. You know? He'll tell you that. They're going to know who I am. They're going to know that I'm this ungodly character. And some of those people knew Angela real well back then because she was in the youth group with the pastor of that church we was going to. And so some of those people in that church knew Angela real well. And this, I don't know if I ever told her this, but I used to think that them people's probably wondering, what in the world is she doing with that guy? I mean, I'm just telling you straight up. What in the world is she doing with that guy? But then again, I'll just be honest with you. There was times I thought the same thing. Right, you know, what in the world is she doing with this guy? But God loved me. God loved me. God still loves me. Jesus died for me. Praise God. He died for me. He died for you. And you. And you. And even Ed. Right? Thank you, Lord. But... and he said, Bill, you can be different. So he wanted us to be different. He tells us to be different. Different takes time. So I've been working on it for 30 years. I'm about to get a handle on it a little bit. Perhaps you know enough. But God loves me, and he loves you. And the Bible tells us, it says, God is love. God is love. See, the world out there, they all think they know what love is. They got this corrupted view about what love is. And it is a corrupted view. They have no clue what love means. Most of them has never read what Paul wrote here. Never read what Paul wrote. And if you read what he wrote right there, you'd find out about what love means. Thank you, Lord. Charity never fails, he said. Love never fails. It never fails. I'm going to tell you, if we will stand up for the Lord Jesus Christ in this day and time, and we will show people love, we will walk in love, and we will show people love, hallelujah, it will not fail. People will turn. People will turn. People will turn. But we've got to stand in love, and we've got to stand our ground, and we've got to know who the Lord Jesus Christ is in our life. It's time to quit playing tiddlywinks in the church and get out there and start being the church. We've got to know that we know that we know that we love the Lord so that other people will know. I'm telling you, it will have an effect. It will have an effect on folks. When the church does what it's supposed to do, it will have an effect on folks. But he told us we were to love. Paul said, love is a great thing. Love. Just flip right over there to 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Real close by. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. And in verses 14 through 17. He said here, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with the light? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. And God has said, I will dwell with them and walk with them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, says the Lord. Be ye separate, says the Lord. Mm-hmm. See, he said, don't be joined together. Don't be unequally yoked with people that are not like us, that are not like, that do not like Christ. Listen, the one thing that I learned back then was when I come to the Lord, I had to turn around and walk away from everybody I knew.
That's right.
And I've been preaching this for years. I had to walk away from all the people that I knew. I didn't even know the Word of God too well back then. Okay? But I knew that if I stayed with those people, I was not going to serve God the way I was supposed to.
Right.
I couldn't
right.
be hanging out with that bunch of heathens.
That's right.
You know? Why? Because that's what I was when I was with them. Now here I am trying to serve the Lord. If I had went back out there and still run around with them and carried on, do you think I'd be standing here today talking to you guys? No, I'd probably be out there just as big a heathen as I ever was. He said, don't be yoked together with those types of people. Now, I'm not talking bad about people, nothing like that, because we were all that way before we come to the Lord. He says, come out from amongst them. Come out. He said, for you to be separate. Be separate. In the way we think, the way we talk, the way we walk, the way, you know, the way that we act, the things that we desire, you know, the things that we desire. Stuff like that, you know. Come out from amongst them. Be the light in the world. Because he said we were the light of the world.
Yes.
Jesus Christ is the light, and he's on the inside of us. We have the light on the inside of us. When people see us, they should see the light of Christ shining out of us. Praise God. I'm telling you, we live in a time, folks. I don't know what's about to happen.
We do.
There's some crazy people running this nation. There's some crazy people running the world.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just the truth of it. Why? Because everything is leading up just like the Lord said he was going to. Do you not know? There's a tribulation coming.
Yes, there is.
There's a tribulation coming. It is on its way. It's closer than it's ever been before. They're gearing up for it. They want it. They want it. Why do they want it? Because in that kind of stuff right there, that's when they gain control. You know, I just seen a video that got sent to me the other day about these big games that was played up. They were like Olympics, but it wasn't Olympics, but it's like Olympic games. And I think it was over in England. Well, this big show that they put on, and I ain't going to go through all this real good, but I'm just going to bring this out. But this big show that they put on, they brought in the Tower of Babel. I don't know if y'all see that. Did y'all see that maybe? They brought in the Tower of Babel. And then they got all of these crystals that was supposed to explode up in the sky and everything. They was praying to these crystals, and then they gave them to the Tower of Babel. And then they brought in the Moloch bull.
Look out.
Now, listen, this is where we live. This is where we are at. This is where we're at. We're headed into the tribulation. It's here. It's here. I don't know how many of y'all have ever read the book of Revelation, okay? But there's some pretty bad stuff going to happen during that time. I don't want people to go there. As much as I don't want people to go to hell, I don't want them to go into that either.
Right.
You know? I don't want them to go into that. But that's where they're headed. Why? Because they're already worshiping false gods. They're already doing it. What did Solomon say? He said, there's nothing new under the sun. Who what was will be. Right? Yeah. You know, we read these things in the Bible back in the Old Testament where they used to do all this kind of stuff. We think, well, that was back then. Uh-huh, it's now. You know, it's now. Yeah. It's now. But see, that's why we have to wake up. We have to wake up. Know that we know that we know that we love the Lord Jesus Christ. And know that we love people. We have to love people.
We don't always have to like them.
But we love them. You know what I mean? Like and love, that's a different thing. There's a lot of people that I love. I love them. Don't like them all that much. Don't want to hang out with them too much. You know, but you know, how many of you know God created us all with a personality? We have personalities, don't we? Some personalities don't always mesh with other personalities. It's just kind of the way it is. And when we kind of understand that, then we get less offended at people. You know what I'm saying? You know, and so, but we can always walk in love towards anybody. It doesn't make no difference. But he told us to come out and be separate. To be separate. That's what we're to do, church. And we are to be separate from the world. They should see something different in us. They should see us loving people. Even when they don't love us. You know, I think about Jesus, right? If there was anybody who had reason not to love people, Jesus was one who had a reason.
Right.
I mean, all the things that they did to him. And that's all he was trying to do, was preach God to them, preach love to them. Preach to them there's a better way. Preach to them there's freedom. You have freedom. All you got to do is receive the Lord.
Yes.
There's a better way. You preach love to them. And what did they do? Amen. They beat him up, crucified him. And while he was up there hanging on that cross, you know, he said, Lord, forgive them. Father, forgive them. I mean, how many of us, and he was up there, he wasn't supposed to be there, right? You know, he hadn't done anything. Even Pilate said, I find no fault with this man to crucify him. You know, Pilate didn't even know the Lord. He's just looking at it from a legal standpoint. You know, he's a politician. He's a governor. He just said, you know, through legal processes, he said, I don't see nothing here that warrants this man being crucified. But Jesus said, forgive them. For they know not what they do. He loved. He loves you. He loves me. Praise God. And many of you sitting in here know just what I told you about myself. Many of you experience the same thing. Come out of a heathen life. Come out of a heathen life. I'm not talking about a life where you just wasn't serving God. You're probably a pretty good person, but you just wasn't serving God. I'm talking about a person who not only didn't serve God, but was a heathen, just through and through, just doing stuff that wasn't good. You know. That's hard to overcome because the devil's the Lord said he forgets about it. He forgives you. He don't have nothing else to do with it. But the devils never forget about it.
No.
And they never let you forget
about
it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Sometimes I have to get on the devil, you know, these days. I'm better at it than I used to be. Sometimes I have to get him. You know, yeah, devil, I do remember. I remember all that stuff, you know. But I tell you what, though, devil. I tell him, Lord, the Lord loves me. The Lord died for me. I've been washed in his blood. Praise God. He told me I could receive salvation, and I did. Praise God, and I'm saved. I said, the Bible says that he don't remember all that stuff. You're telling me things that God don't even know nothing about now. So I said, praise God, you just get away from me with all of that. I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. I have authority over you, so I don't have to deal with all of this mess. Right? You know, I said, you know what? One of these days, praise God, praise God, praise God, I'm going to be in heaven with the Lord where I'm never going to hear about this ever again. And you're going to be down in hell always knowing about the stuff that you did. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And I said, well, I'm going to be different then. There ain't no doubt in my mind. Praise God. So get away from me with your stuff.
Yes.
You have to get belligerent. I have to get belligerent sometimes because he tries to bombard me because he still tries to tell me, who do you think you are?
Yeah.
Amen.
Who do you think you are? And whenever I hear that, I always know, don't you remember is coming right after that. You know what I mean? But sometimes if you hear that come up in you, you can stop him, cut him short right there. Who do I think I am? I'm a child of the living God. I'm a child of the living God. You can tell me.
Thank you, Jesus.
But that's because Jesus loves you. That's why you have that ability. That's why you have that assurance on the inside of you. Why? Because you believe the Word of God. You read the Word of God. You accepted the Word of God into your life, and you believe it. You believe it. And when you believe it, you will exercise it in your life. Now, it might not be as easy in the earlier days, but the more you do it, the better at it you get. and the less beat up you get.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's, I'm just telling, I know this because I know it from experience.
Yeah.
I mean, back in the early days, man, it's a wonder I didn't walk around with black eyes and everything, you know, because I got beat up so much. That's why I told you, I just knew people just knew me. And you know, none of them people in that church knew me. They wouldn't know anything about me if I would have told them some stuff.
Right.
You know, none of them knew me. They all knew Angela, but they didn't know me. Yeah. But I thought they did. But we got to also remember who it is that we're fighting against, you know. Ephesians 6, 12 through 17 says, "For we don't wrestle against flesh and blood." We don't wrestle against flesh and blood. When we start to understand, praise God, that we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, praise the Lord, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. These are the things that we fight against. You know, all this stuff that we see going on in the world, we're not fighting against those people. We're fighting against the demonic powers that are behind them.
Right.
The demonic powers that are behind them. Well, how do you know that, Pastor Bill? Well, let me just give you one good reference, okay? Anybody in here read Daniel? All right? All right. Now, when you read in Daniel, and Daniel prayed. Now, Daniel was used to getting his prayers answered. And, you know, when he prayed, he knew the Lord was going to answer him. So he prayed, and he wasn't getting no answer. So he wasn't going to quit praying, you know. He wasn't getting no answer. And finally, the angel come through to him, right? And he said, "Oh, Daniel." He said, "The very day you prayed, God sent the answer." He said, "But I got held up by the Prince of Persia." The Prince of Persia. Been having to battle him, and then Michael come to help me. So who was the Prince of Persia? It wasn't the prince that's sitting on no throne, no earthly throne. It was the heavenly host that was assigned to that area, to that kingdom. It was a principality. It was a spiritual wickedness. It was an authority that had authority to do what he did.
Yeah.
And there are authorities just like that that are over this nation, that are over different governmental officials and stuff like that. There's authority signed to you, right, to make your life miserable.
Come on.
You know, all of these kinds of things. And so when we start to understand that we're not fighting against the world, we're fighting against spiritual authorities. And that we know that we have the Lord Jesus Christ. We have all authority given to us by the Lord Jesus Christ through his death, burial, and resurrection. Praise God. And then I'm going to tell you, hallelujah, when you get that, and then all of a sudden you find out that there's a baptism in the Holy Ghost, because he said, once you receive the Holy Spirit, he said, you'll receive power. Praise God. He said, you're going to be fired up. Hallelujah. You're going to have a power that this devil can't deal with. Praise God. You receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and you start really whipping out the word on them. Oh, praise God. You'll put the fear in them.
Amen.
Put the fear in them. They might come messing with you, but they'll remember the last time. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to tell you, God told me I needed to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Even though I told my wife we didn't need all that stuff. I did. That's what I told her. You know. Again, remember, this is heathen days. All right? No. Bob said, renew your thinking. I did. You know. But back then, you know, I was struggling. I wanted to go to church, but I was raised up, you know, I was raised up Baptist for the most part. They didn't believe in the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and they said that all that tongue stuff, keep that away.
Yeah.
How did I know that? Because my grandmama got baptized in the Holy Ghost, and most of my family was Baptist.
Yeah. Cool.
And they wouldn't. But I knew about this much about that stuff. I didn't know much about it. I heard my family say, you know, that's of the devil.
Oh.
You know. So I didn't know anything about it. So when I come back to church, I was confused about that. And she's raised up in Pentecostal church. She wanted to go to church like that. I said, no. That's what I told her. I said, well, you know, man's the head of the household, right? I said, we're going to get a little Baptist church. I said, we'll be all right. And she asked me, she said, you don't believe in the baptism of the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues? I said, well, I didn't say I didn't believe in it. I said, we just don't need all that stuff. That's what I told her. Hey, that's a direct quote. I said, we just don't need all that stuff. And that's what I told her. But you know what? I wasn't the smartest man in the world. Still ain't. But I had enough sense about me that I talked to the Lord about it.
Come on.
Right. And I did. Because I had a desire to go to church.
There.
And so I talked to the Lord about it. And I said, Lord, I said, I don't know where to go to church. I said, you know me. I've been out in the world for so long. I said, I don't know where to go to church, Lord. I said, but if you'll tell me where I want to go, where you want me to go to church, you'll take me there and let me know when I get there. I said, I'll stay. I said, I'll do the best I can to do whatever you want me to do. So that's how me and Ash, we started going to different churches. You know, we visited Baptist churches. We visited some spirit-filled churches. And they all seemed perfectly fine to me. But none of them moved me. Yeah. None of them moved me. And then she asked me one day if we'd go to this one church because the pastors there used to be her youth pastors at Faith is a Victory. Yeah. Okay. You know, I mean, I didn't care, right? You know. So we went in there. Let me tell you, we went in there and the Holy Ghost got a hold of me. Holy Ghost got a hold of me. We sat down in that church now. Because now, see, I asked the Lord. I said, if you'll let me know when I get there. Right? Yeah. And when I come into that church, the Holy Ghost got a hold of me. I had never experienced nothing like that in my whole life. I didn't know how to handle it. You know, I mean, I was sitting there, man, and listening to all that stuff. I mean, I was saying a word, just, and then finally we got up, and the service was over with, and we got up and left, and I didn't say a word, wouldn't talk. Right, you know, and it was like over an hour, and finally, and she just thought I hated the church. Because I wouldn't say nothing, and that's what she asked me. She said, you hated it, didn't you? I said, no. I said, as a matter of fact, we'll go back. Because I felt the power of the Holy Ghost.
Oh, yeah.
I never felt that before in my life, you know. Pastor God, I never felt that. And I felt the power of the Holy Ghost come on me. And the Lord said, this is where I want you to go. This is where I want you to go. And I had to go talk to my grandmama to find out a few things because I didn't understand none of this. Only thing I knew is that was where the Lord told me to go. And I knew that. I was confident about that. You know, there's not a lot of things I've always been sure about over all these years. But there's been certain things that I knew that the Lord spoke to me and I was as sure about it as I could be. And I haven't questioned it from that day. Whenever I heard it, whenever I felt it, whenever I knew that I knew that I knew it was from God, you can't take it away from me. You can't get me to look away from it. You can't. It just is what it is. And if people have a problem with it, they just have to have a problem with it and they take it up with God. But I'm not going to go and stand before God one day and have him tell me, well, I told you about this right here. And me say, well, you know, so-and-so come and told me this right here. Well, who are you trying to follow? Me or so-and-so?
Right.
So I said, well, I'll just stay with you, Lord. Perhaps, you know, because I knew that I knew that the Lord took me there.
Yes.
I knew that.
Thank you, Lord.
And I got baptized in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Baptized in the Holy Ghost in that place. Most awesome experience. If you ain't baptized in the Holy Spirit, if you're born again, you ain't baptized in the Holy Spirit, I'm going to tell you, you're running on half a tank. You need a good fill up, praise God.
Yeah.
We got stuff, man. We got stuff out here to have to deal with in this world. And we need the power. Jesus said you receive power when you receive the Holy Ghost. He said you receive power, praise God. I'm going to tell you, we need power. We need all the power we can get, praise God. And so if you're not baptized in the Holy Spirit, then you need to come and be baptized in the Holy Spirit. God's just wanting you to do it. It's not no real hard thing to have to do. Just go and receive it. Tell him, I want it, praise God. I want all that you got for me, Lord.
Amen.
And that's what I did. Hallelujah. He baptized me in the Holy Ghost. Not only did he baptize me in the Holy Ghost, but he showed me, praise God. He showed me after it was all said and done. He showed me that I was on the right path, that I was doing the right thing, praise God, and I was right where he wanted me to be. Because I walked out of that building that day, hallelujah, let me tell you, walked out of that building, boy, I reached off in my pockets. Let me tell you what I did. If I reached in my pockets and I pulled out this pack of cigarettes. Woo! I lit me one up because
yeah.
I was a smoking somebody back in.
Yeah.
Right? You know? Yes, I did. Yes, I did. Just got baptized in the Holy Ghost. I lit me up a cigarette.
Oh,
Yeah, no. Because see, I had no intention to quit smoking. I was going to quit smoking just because I was going to church, you know. And I lit that cigarette up. And I took me about 2 hits off that cigarette. And I turned around and looked at Angela. And I said, Angela, I said, I don't smoke anymore. I didn't tell her I was going to quit. I said, I don't smoke anymore. You know, man, I throw that thing. There was an ashtray there on out there because our church was in a storefront. And there was a little ashtray thing. I put that thing in there and I threw the pack in the trash can. And when I got home, I still had the rest of a carton at the house. I throwed it in the trash can. God delivered me. God delivered me that day. He said, you shall receive power. And he showed me, praise God. There's power in the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Because I had no power for me to quit smoking. I had no power for me to quit smoking. I did not so much the power. I had no desire. I had no desire. The last time I tried to quit smoking and I failed, I said these words out loud. Let me tell you, if you don't think your words mean something, let me tell you that they do, right? I spoke these words out loud. I said, this is stupid, me quitting smoking. I love smoking. I'm never going to try to quit smoking again. I'm going to smoke till I die. And when I die, I'm going to have them throw a carton in the casket with me so I can take them with me. And that was my deal. That's the word I spoke them words out. God knew that I had no intentions of quitting smoking. But he had a different intention for me. He showed me, praise God, there's power in the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He said, I'm here with you. I love you. I called you. I filled you with the Holy Spirit. Praise God, I delivered you. Praise God. Don't ever think that you're less of a person than you are. You know, the Bible tells us that we should not think of ourselves more highly than we are, right? We should not think more highly of ourselves than we are. But I'm going to tell you, we should not think more lowly of ourselves than we ought to. Praise God. That's one thing that the Lord has tried to get across to me for many years. God loves you. He called you. You get baptized in the Holy Ghost. Understand there is a power. You will receive a power. God will do things with you just as he's done with anybody else. He will use you. There will be powerful things that will happen out of you. Praise God. Don't make no difference who you are, what you've done, what's happened in your life. God will use you. God will use you. He will deliver you. Praise God.
Yes.
He showed me that day there's power in the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I haven't looked back since.
Amen.
Yes.
That pastor that I was going to church with there at that time, he needed somebody to come and to go to a church camp, a youth camp. He needed another sponsor, another chaperone is what it was, for the boys. You know, here I am, I still feel heathenized, just baptized in the Holy Ghost. Because you got to work stuff out, you know. You don't feel worthy to do things, all right? You know?
You
got to work stuff out. But he come to me, right? He said, Bill, you know what his first question was? He said, are you still smoking? Because I testified that I got delivered, but you know people, they'll tell you stuff, right? You know? And he said, are you still smoking? I said, no, Pastor. This has been several months. I said, no. I said, I ain't smoked a cigarette since that day I got baptized in the Holy Ghost.
Woo-hoo!
You know, I was testifying to him again, you know. I said, he delivered me. I said, I don't want one. I ain't smoked one. Don't have no desire for one or nothing. I said, it's gone. He said, good. He said, well, you go to your church camp. He didn't want to see me if I was smoking. Yeah. He said, will you go to the youth camp? He said, I need a sponsor, a chaperone for these boys. I said, okay. It's just true stuff, man. It's kind of fun. But God said he'd give you power. He gave me power. And all I had to do was go to youth camp. I was just a chaperone. I wasn't expected to do anything. Just chaperone the boys that were with us, you know. That's all. You know, so I did that, okay. But I do remember when he first asked us to do the children's ministry, to work in the children's ministry, you know. And I wanted to do something. I wanted to do something for the Lord. Right, you know, but that just, y'all don't know, listen, teaching, y'all don't know how I got out of high school. You know, I didn't feel like a teacher. Right, y'all? I'm just telling you. Yeah? And I didn't know that much about the Bible. And so, but we agreed, we would do it, you know. Well, praise God, they had a curriculum, you know. I mean, so I read it. I didn't know much about it still. But I said, you know, I guess I can just stand up in front of them kids and I can just stand up and read it.
Right.
You know, if nothing else, I mean, I just read off what it said. You know,
it worked.
But you know what? I was so nervous, right? Because I said, I know them kids going to see right through me. They're going to eat me alive. Yeah. That's what I thought. That's my thought, you know. I mean, they see right through me. They know I'm not this big godly teacher kind of guy, right? And these kids probably been raised up in church, know twice as much about the Bible than I know. I said, they're going to eat me alive, right? And I got, it's a true story. I got up there. My knees was knocking so bad. I was nervous. I mean, I was so nervous about just teaching little kids, right? You know? And, you know, I found out them kids didn't know me. They didn't know nothing about me. They looked at me. They thought I was the big preacher. You know what I mean? They didn't know I didn't know nothing. And the Lord helped me. He said, I'll give you power.
Amen.
He said, I'll give you power. Now, you might not be thinking, what's power about that? You know, just to teach a kid. Listen, I needed Holy Ghost power to do that. That's just a fact of the matter. I needed Holy Ghost power to be able to do that right there, you know. That's just a fact of the matter.
That's the truth.
We taught that class. We went through there. Praise God. Now, the pastor told me when he asked me to do that, he said, if you'll do it for me for 6 months, he said, if you'll just commit for 6 months, he said, I'll rotate you out, okay, and get somebody else to do it. I said, all right. 7 years later, I went back to him, right?
Great.
I said, Pastor Jim, right? Yeah. I said, what about that rotation? He said, what are you talking about, Bill? I said, you told me if I do this, you'd rotate me out in 6 months. Well, you know. He looked at me kind of bug-puzzled. He said, Bill, do you want to be rotated out? I said, no. I said, I just wanted to remind you because I thought maybe you forgot. I mean, because we have been in there now for about 7 years. Right, you know. That children's ministry was one of the greatest things that God could have ever done for me and Angel. Because God taught me something in that. One thing, He taught me that I could do things that I didn't think I could do. Because me and Ange did some pretty amazing things in that I would have never thought this old heathen guy would have done, and there was a time I wouldn't have. We created a set of clowns. Yeah. Danny and Loretta, they remember, right? Danny and Lorinda, remember, they have a visual, right? Outside of me and Hans, they're the only moon people in this building that are going to have a visual of that. Right? But why did we do that? We created these clowns, Boomer and Sparkles. There are pictures, I'm just not going to show them to you. Why did we do that? Because God had put a love in us. He put a love in me for those kids. That this rough, gruff, druggie, and that's what I was, you know, would come out of that world. Come to the Lord and feel the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. And take some time to renew my mind to the Word of God and to believe that God could really love me. And then I would do things like that right there. Why? Because I'm just trying to minister to children. And what do children relate to? You know, you minister to children in things that they relate to. Those kids love those clowns. And so did a bunch of adults. We ended up having to do a bunch of adult programs too. Right, you know. Hey, we went to Jackson, Tennessee. We went to Jackson, Tennessee to a big Women's Aglow meeting. They had a big, their big I mean, people come from everywhere to this thing. It was, you know, but there was a lady that was over this in our church, and she said, "Would y'all come do your clown act for us?" Man, okay. We went down, it was so good. That's how God is, though. God is so good. He's so good, so good, right?
So good.
Let me tell you, He'll equip you for things if you let Him,
right? Yeah, right.
Here we was. We was trying to put together a skit for them, for down there. And I decided, let's use a book. We had a book that had a bunch of different skits in it. But me and Angie had actually been writing all our own skits, doing everything that we did. We did it ourselves, right? And so, but we had this book, and I'm thinking, man, let's just use one of these skits out of this book, and that's what we'll do down there. I said, it'd be easier. We just got everything right there. We just have to practice it. And so that's what we were doing. And we were practicing it, and then time was getting closer and closer and closer, and it was not working. It was just not working. And I'm like, man, this is bad, and we don't have much time. And so now here we was, what, we had like 3 days left, I think it was, before this big meeting. And I was talking to her, and I said, "Angie, this is just not working." I said, "We can't go down there and do this." She said, "Well, what are we going to do?" I said, "I don't know." So I said, "Well, call her up. What was her name?"
Mertis,
yes. Thank you. Jerry Mertis.
Thank you.
Yeah. Mertis was her name. Right? I said, "Call her up," and I said, "You ask them, do they have some kind of theme for this meeting, you know?" She said, "All right." So she did. And it was Vessels of Honor, I think is what it was called. But let me tell you, the Holy Ghost will equip you. Right? If you'll let Him, you'll trust Him, He'll let you. I'm going to tell you, we sat down, and this is no lie, and we wrote a skit around Vessels of Honor. And we wrote it out. And it probably took us about an hour to write this thing out. And we had about 3 days to practice it.
Wow.
You know? And we still didn't have all the lines down. We're driving down there. Me and her still practicing our lines, driving out there.
Nice.
We were up in the room getting our costumes on. And we're still practicing the lines. You know. But when we walked out there, praise God,
amen.
The anointing of the Holy Ghost hit.
Woo!
Oh, yeah.
It hit a couple of clams.
Hallelujah.
It hit a couple of clams. And we took off and we did our thing, and it was awesome.
Mm-hmm.
It was awesome. God, were you there, Lorinda? Did you go?
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe she
asked her
if it was
awesome. Was it awesome? But I don't tell a lie. You know.
It just didn't have to be there.
But it was awesome. The power of the Holy Ghost. If you ain't baptized in the Holy Spirit, you should be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And folks, we got to learn to love. The Lord's really been on me about this, and it's been on me now for a while. And I asked the Lord, "Please, Lord, show me how to love, because I don't feel like I love good enough. I don't. I always feel like I'm that I could do better, right?" And I asked the Lord, "Show me how to love. Show me how to love people. You know." Now I'm not talking about this ooey gooey mushy kind of love. That's not what I'm talking about. You know. I'm talking about just having a heart for people, just loving people, desiring to see people miss a judgment that's coming.
Yeah.
We're right on the heels of it.
Yeah.
Desiring to see people miss that place called hell. Just a love for people, no matter who they are, what they do, or how they act, you know, and whatnot. We've got to learn how to love. The Holy Ghost will help you learn how to love. And if you're not baptized in the Holy Spirit, you should be baptized in the Holy Spirit. If you're in here and you're born again, but you've never been baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. And I'm going to tell you, if you get baptized in the Holy Ghost, you will speak in tongues. Because that's what the Bible says.
Amen.
And don't try to understand it. Don't try to think about it. Just receive it. Just receive it. Man, if I'd have got up there that day and thought about all of that stuff, I'd still been standing up there trying to get it, even today. But I didn't think about it. My grandmother showed that to me in the Bible. she showed me where Paul said, if a man speaks in an unknown tongue, he speaks not to man, but to God. And that's the only thing that she showed me that I understood. I didn't understand none of that other stuff. She went through the whole Pentecost and everything with me. And I told the Lord that. I said, Lord, I don't understand any of that stuff my grandmother told me. I said, but I understand this. If a man speaks in an unknown tongue, speaks not to man, but to God. I said, so Lord, that tells me that if I receive this baptism of the Holy Ghost and I receive speaking in tongues, that's because I'm going to be speaking to you. So I said, I can receive that, Lord. I can wrap my mind around that. I said, everything else, I said, you have to help me with everything else. But I said, for now, I said, I can grab a hold of that. And that's what I did. And let me tell you, I went up there, I got baptized in the Holy Ghost, praise God, and I started speaking in tongues. I ain't quit since. You know, I don't think about it. I just do it. Because that's what the Lord told me.
That's right.
But he said, you should receive power. There's power. When you pray in the Spirit, you receive power. There's power in that. But love people. Love people. Love people. Maybe you'd be standing out in the line somewhere. Me and Angie, we was just recently in a fast food restaurant. We got duped on pretty good, you know. And because here we had our order in, right? It's taking forever. And then all these other people come in behind us. And they start putting their order in. And then all of a sudden, boop, 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 they're all getting their order. I'm like, well, where's ours at? You know?
Yeah.
And so... So I go up to the counter, you know, and I ask them, and they say, oh, we thought you already had your ours sitting over on the counter over there, getting cold.
Oh.
You know, they done forgot about us, put it together, sat over, forgot about us. Now, you know, that old devil, he said, man, he said, you ought to jump them about that. He said, that's just wrong. They did you wrong. That's what you hear coming. But, you know, I thought, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to walk in love over this. Yeah. And they were apologizing. I told them, look here. I said, it's all right. It ain't no problem. I said, everything's good. Don't worry about it. It's good. It's good. Took our bag, and we left there, and we went home and ate cold tacos.
That's right.
I mean, yeah, praise God. It's the way it was, you know. And sometimes you have to speak to yourself like that. You know, because I'm not telling you the devil won't come at you. Because he will. Right? Just learn. But I know y'all done already prayed for everybody. That's good too. Praise God. Man, the Spirit of God been moving in here. I mean, praise God. It makes you want to dance. Well, me, maybe not y'all, but I don't know. Praise God. But if you're in here today and you've never been baptized in the Holy Ghost, I want to extend the invitation. If you've never been